Hi there, Lindsay here. Today we're going to take a look at the September Smart Art Box, and it is a fun one. There's lots of different stuff in this one. So up first, we have the Ecoline brush pens, and I've been curious to try these for a while. I've had people asking me to review them, but they're not as common here in America as they are in Europe, so I'm excited for those. We also have some Duralar film, which is a matte kind of frosted plastic. If you kind of think of like what a milk jug looks like, that's kind of the color, sheen, and texture that we have here. So that's kind of interesting. We had the clear Duralar in the stained glass box, which was fun. And here we have alcohol inks by Merabu. And I've heard really good things about their alcohol inks, especially their glitter medium, which came in this kit. So there was five colors. You have primaries plus a purple and a green, and then this beautiful glitter, which you'll see me use in a bit. Plus it comes with a small brush and three sheets of ready cut watercolor paper, the Strathmore 100% cotton 500 series, which I really like that paper. So first thing I did was I wanted to test out these brush pens. They're very responsive. I'm not a calligraphy doer. What do you call those people that do calligraphy? Calligrapher? I'm not one of those, clearly. But I did like that I could get thick and thin lines really easily in my unskilled hands. And then this is just the blending brush. I was curious as to how it would blend the colors that I had laid down. I also wanted to try kind of mixing some colors to see what sort of variety of colors I would get. And the colors did mix really well and cleanly. Now these pens are like your typical dye-based watercolor, kind of like your liquid watercolors that aren't pigment-based. Like if you, you know how like Dr. P.H. Martens makes hydrous watercolors, liquid watercolors, and they're pigmenty, and they have the radiants, which are like dye, and the radiants fade and the pigment ones don't. The pigment ones are just like kind of like actual watercolors. Well, these are more like the dye-based colors, like most of your markers, except for like the Winsor & Newton ones. So they're pretty much what I expected. I did grab a palette so I could do some mixing on the palette, because I found that trying to mix them on paper, the fibery tip, it's kind of like a Tombow tip, you know, the fibery tip just doesn't want to blend very well in watercolor paper, and it almost wants to shred it. So I knew that if I scribbled it on a palette, then I could mix it. And this is just actually a vintage deviled egg tray that my husband picked up for me at an antiques market once, and I just thought it was so cool for like a palette. So here I'm just going to show you swatching them out after they're watered down. Now these don't have a really high tinting strength when you do it this way, but I did find the colors mixed really cleanly. And you know, if you're going to use this as watercolors, you'll need to scribble out quite a bit. And in fact, I don't think that's the best use for this, unless you're going to put these like in a travel bag and you just want something to give you a little bit of watercolor, like in a sketchbook. Because like I mentioned before, these are dye based and they will fade, but they flow well and they're just kind of fun to use. Now I was just playing here with the alcohol inks, and I ended up actually making something that I'm going to use in the project today. I think the best way to get to know your supplies is just to play with them, because sometimes we get so overwhelmed with like, well, we don't want to waste it. What are we going to do with it? And it becomes this big epic thing, and then you don't end up doing anything with it. So I was just playing with these. Now, the way these alcohol inks come, it's different than other bottles. You actually take a pin, like a thumbtack, and you poke it in the top of the tip, and then it comes with a cap. You take the cap off, you poke that in the top of the nozzle tip, and then you use it like this, and then the cap just snaps on. So you don't have to unscrew caps. I don't think they'll get stuck. Like sometimes the Tim Holtz and the Pinata inks get stuck. The caps will get dried and stuck on there. So I think that's kind of neat. I was really curious about these colors that they sent are really beautiful and clean and mix really well. Honestly, I honestly don't think they needed to send the purple and the green, because the primary colors mixed so well that, I mean, you really don't even need the green. So if you're buying these and you want to just get a few colors, get the magenta, the cyan blue, I think it's called, and the yellow, and you're going to be good, because they mix. Get that glitter. That glitter stuff's pretty awesome. And then I was just playing with spraying some just household alcohol on it and getting them to flow. I just basically wanted to make a translucent background. I didn't know what I was going to do with it yet, but I figured, you know, I could mix and match these things together and come up with something that would be kind of fun. And I just basically, my goal here was to fill this paper with some interesting, or Duralar, I guess it's not really paper, it's like a plastic. I just wanted to fill this with some interesting colors and sheens. If I was going to do this over, I would just do the primary colors and the glittery stuff because I think I just kind of ran into almost making mud because I was just playing with too many colors. But I really think this is pretty and I set it aside to dry. I would also use this on that clear Duralar, which I got in the other Smart Art box, which I misplaced. I could not find that clear Duralar, but I think that would be really cool too. So you should definitely keep your supplies, even if you're not sure if they're for you. Sometimes you'll get another supply that will work with something you already have, and it will give you a brainstorm. So as long as it doesn't take up too much space and you think you might use it again, it doesn't hurt to hang on to it, especially something that's like clear acetate, like the Duralar. You can always use it as in a shaker box or a shaker card or something like that. So I wanted to do kind of like a background. I wanted to make a greeting card here. So I took a piece of the 8x10 paper and I trimmed an inch off it. So I had a 7x10 and I folded it in half to make a 5x7 card. And I watered down the inks and I wet the back of the paper and I'm just doing an ombre gradient. I was thinking of doing a sunset, but after I had it all painted, I'm like, oh, that's a little lighter than I wanted. So I decided to go over. Now here I'm experimenting by taking the marker and painting right on wet paper, but I could definitely feel the friction between the nib and the wet paper, and I thought this is gonna peel. That's not a great idea. So I went ahead and spread that out, and I decided I would do my scribbling onto the palette and keep putting it on that way until I got to my achieved a darkness of color. And now I'm just drying it with my heat tool, and I got a really nice smooth blend. Now, one thing I was curious about this was whether these would react with water, because I love that look. Like, you know when you use distress inks in your background of your card and then you flick water on it and you get that really cool effect? Well, I was wondering if these would work that way, and they do. So I was really pleased with this because I think this is such a wonderful way to do a background or give you some interesting effects, whether you're doing a watercolor painting, a sketchbook work, or you making a greeting card like I am today. I truly believe that these techniques that you learn can cross over. I think that the line between craft and art these days is definitely blurred, and I think it should be. I don't think you should be afraid or ashamed to use any technique from craft or from art, and vice versa. These are techniques meant for everyone to enjoy. So try stuff, experiment, have fun. That's why we do art, that's why we have hobbies, and that's why we create. So I added some more spattering of the colors because I thought that would look nice on top of the white spatters, and I also wanted to build a frame. So I'm going right in. My paper's dry now. I'm going right in with that black brush pen, and I'm drawing a frame half on masking tape and half on the paper because I knew it wouldn't dry in the masking tape. So if I went in with a wet brush, I could liquefy that ink that's on the tape and push it into the card a little bit, giving me a really nice border that's dense at the edge and that kind of fades off into spatters as we work inward. The thing I like about making a greeting card is because sometimes art can feel too precious and you don't want to mess it up, but a card is small, it's a great place to experiment, and when you're done, you can mail it to a friend, so it's very practical. Sometimes I feel like if I'm working in a sketchbook, nobody's going to see it, I'm just going to put it away. It's almost going to go to waste. Not that I really think it's going to waste, but something like this is something that will be used when you're done. And I think sometimes you're just in the mood to create something like that. So I removed my masking tape, and here's a tip. You heat, you like dry it, make sure your paper's dry before you remove your tape. And if you use a heat tool to dry it, remove the tape while it's still warm because the tape will come off much easier. Now I'm comparing the Duralar to my background, and I see the colors go together really nicely. Now I wanted to make an element for my card that would be interactive or at least movable. So I decided I would make a butterfly on the Duralar. And then I'm using an embossing tinsel, which is like a glitter and embossing powder mix, and I used an ink that was not going to dry on that plastic. It was VersaFine, and actually, probably most inks aren't going to dry in that plastic very well. So I knew that if I embossed it with an embossing powder, it would seal that ink down. Plus, this will give me a pretty glittery effect. Now, you do have to be a little careful when you use a heat tool to emboss on these plastic films because it's going to want to warp the plastic. But I actually wanted that effect because I wanted the butterfly to feel kind of like I wanted it to flutter. I wanted the wings to be a little curved. And I knew by doing that with the heat tool, by heat embossing it, it was going to bend my plastic a little bit and give me that motion. I also took that brush pen and inked up a big text stamp I've had for ages and stamped that along the edge just to give it a little extra pattern and give it a little more design and interest. I was just going to do one butterfly, but then I realized I really needed a couple others, so I dug in my stash for some older, smaller butterflies, and I stamped them on other portions of the Duralar that I thought was really pretty. Now, when you're doing a background like this, things change when it dries. I'm telling you, you walk away, and I don't know what happens, but things shift and move and change. So sometimes you'll have to, you know, you'll get parts of the background you really like, and others that you're like, ugh, that's muddy, a muddy mess. So this way I was able to utilize those portions of the background that I liked and put them to use on my card. So keep that in mind. If you make a background and you're like, oh, gee, I don't really like that, well, maybe you have enough that you can cut it into a bookmark or gift tag, or you can collage with it. You can use it to collage a part of a different piece of artwork. So, you know, look at, sometimes the parts are better than the whole when you're doing a background, and keep that in mind. No matter what you do for your art, whether you're an art journaler or you're a card maker, you're a painter, you know, look at the pieces, because you might have something that's going to work out even better than you ever imagined. Now, to adhere this, I am using Beacon 3-in-1 adhesive behind the stamped area, so it's going to hide the glue, and also so it'll keep my wings kind of fluttery. So I bent the Duralar, creased it at the wings, and I'm just gluing those the larger butterflies down by the center body, and the tiny one I just glued down on a whole wing in the center, just so it have, you know, plenty to stick to. If you enjoyed this, you might want to check out smartartbox.com. They send out monthly kits with fun art supplies to kind of kindle that creative fire that you have within you. I'll have all the details down below. Check it out if you're curious. Until next time, happy crafting!